All right, well, welcome to Facebook Live on Peace Baptist Church. Hope you're all doing well. You know, we're dealing with a lot of things around us now, and we do want to keep your safety as number one. So that's why we're doing it this way. We do want to encourage you that as soon as things start to get better, that you get back to church. If you're not in church and these messages have meant something to you and you're looking for a church, there's a lot of great churches in Columbus County. We'd love for you to get involved in one. And if you don't have a church home, we'd love to invite you to Peace. All services of ours will be online through Facebook in the next few weeks. And as things progress or change, then we'll keep you updated as we go. But each Sunday morning, we will have a live feed at 9 o'clock and at 10 o'clock. And then on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock. They will be recorded, so if you know of someone needing a copy that may not have access to the internet, may not have access to Facebook Live, they want a copy, they'll just contact the church and speak with Miss Carol. Then she can get them a copy, and if they'll just leave their name and address, she'll get them out the next day. The church number is 910-642-0251. This week, we will migrate sermons over to our church YouTube channel as well. So you can go to Peace Baptist Church on YouTube, and you'll be able to find the messages there. We also want to encourage you to continue to tithe, as we still have a lot of people in our community and around the world that we need to reach. There's three ways you can do that. Number one, you can do it online through www.peacebc.org. Click the Give button, and you can give that way. Or you can do it through our church app. And if you're not sure how to get the church app, if you'll contact the church, once again, speak with Miss Carol. She can walk you through that and get you on there, and then you can give that way as well. And you can also mail or drop any tithes, because we still need to continue the work of the kingdom. So we pray that you'll help us with that. And lastly, the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We'll be doing that next few weeks, if you want to give that, when you give your tithe, if you'll mark on there, either through our app or when you write your check or whatever it may be, just earmark it for Annie Armstrong offering, and we'll make sure that it gets in the right place. Speaking of Annie Armstrong, we were going to show you a brief video. Some people are very aware of what Annie Armstrong Easter offering stands for, but some are not, so we want to share that with you. And then Pastor Stephen's wife, Miss Ashton's going to come up and give you some verses, and then Pastor Stephen Beatrice. Thank you. Once again, take care of yourself. These are unsettled times. We really don't know which way things are going, but just trust that things are going to work out the way they should. Thank you.
For almost 100 years, in big cities with 100 skyscrapers, in tiny towns with one stoplight, on college campuses and Native American reservations, in churches too many to count, hundreds of thousands of men and women and boys and girls have made hundreds of thousands of life-changing decisions. Almost none of them knew her name, and yet she was there. Annie Armstrong lived more than 100 years ago. Only this one picture of her survives. History could have easily forgotten her. But Annie Armstrong is worth remembering. In the late 1800s, when most women had no voice, Annie was one of the first to speak up. First, for the urban poor in her hometown of Baltimore, and then for Southern Baptist missionaries around the world who desperately needed support. It was for these people that she helped start the National Women's Missionary Union as its first executive leader. She gave women a platform in their local church and in ways that they'd never done before. These women helped focus Southern Baptist attention on the hurting and the lost and the missionaries trying to reach them. Annie wrote letters, 18,000 in just 1 year, and she traveled across America, encouraging missionaries and inspiring churches to pray, to give, and to act. She worked long hours, paid her own expenses, and refused to accept a salary. And in the darkest days of the Depression, right before she died, an offering was named after her. Today, the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering helps missionaries in the U.S. and Canada start new churches and meet needs through compassion ministries. Over the years, Southern Baptists have given more than $1 billion to that offering, and 100% of it, every penny, has gone straight to the mission field. There's still work left to do. The need is bigger than ever, and that's why, even though she lived more than a century ago, and even though only one picture of her survives, Annie Armstrong's influence lives on. Because today in North America, just as it's been from the beginning, anywhere a missionary is sent, every time a new church is born, anytime someone gives to her offering so that a lost person might be found, Annie is there.
Sovereignty and providence through it all. So I'm going to read a verse in the book of Philippians. Philippians was written by Paul. He wrote that this towards the end of his life while he was in prison, and he was writing this letter to the church of Philippi. And a lot of how Paul was feeling in this verse is how I've been feeling this morning. So in Philippians chapter 1, verse 8, "For God is my witness, how deeply I miss all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus." So peace, I just want you to know that I miss you very much, and I can't wait until we can come and gather together. Paul, he was stuck in prison, and he couldn't physically be with the church in Philippi, but he wrote them a letter. So I'm thankful that even though I can't physically be with you, we can still communicate through Facebook Live, text messages, phone calls, social media. I just want to let you know I miss you, and I'll be thankful when God allows us to be together again. Let's pray. God, I ask that you just come down to all of us. God, help us to fight the good fight while we're facing the unknown. God, through the unknown, through all the anxiety, God, I just ask that you still help us to see your providence and your sovereignty, and help us to see that you're sovereign even though all this chaos is going on in the world today. God, help us to acknowledge your lordship. God, help us to acknowledge your lordship through our actions, through our decisions. And God, help us to be consumed with you. God, just how we're consumed with what's going on around us, help us to be consumed with you. And God, help us to recognize your lordship, and help us to be consumed with you. And because you sent your son to die on the cross, help us to know why we do those things. God, I just ask that you anoint Stephen from the top of his head to the sole of his feet. God, help it to flow out to all of those in the congregation, and to even to those people live. So God, I just ask that you bless the sermon, work on hearts, and God, give us strength as we face the unknown. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I want to say good morning to you all on Facebook Live. This morning, a part of my quiet time, I was reading the book of Philippians, and after my wife, during the time she was getting ready for this morning, she just started crying, and I was like, "What are you crying about?" And she says, I miss the people at peace. And I said, "Man, I just read this verse that goes along with what you're feeling right now. So it's okay to weep. It's okay to cry." And we're not making that up. Lord knows that that truly happened this morning. So I said, "Man, just read this verse. Read what Paul said about him missing the people at the church of Philippi." And so, peace, we miss you. But let this be a time of just us trusting the Lord. Let this be a time of us
continuing the mission. The mission doesn't stop. God is still calling us to be on mission for His glory, even during these times. And so we thank you. We thank you for the phone calls, the prayers, and just let us know how we can serve you this week. Call us, and we'll be here. And so, anyways, turn your Bibles to the book of 3 John, chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 9 through 12 this morning. And when you're there, type word. And if you're here, say word. We continue to believe that this is God's word. And something God's been doing in my heart is this. Specifically, since I'm here at the church, there's only a few people here that's involved with getting this on Facebook Live. I've learned that my preaching is not determined by how many people are in the room. My preaching is determined by Christ alone being in the room. Amen. And so this morning, I'm going to just preach with the mindset that God is in the room and with the mindset that God administered to you that's watching on Facebook Live. So I'm going to read 3 John chapter 1, verses 9 through 12. When you're there, just type word or say word. Verse 9, I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. I'm going to just say this before I continue to read. Diotrephes had a heart to lead, but he didn't have a heart to lead with Christ's love. See, you can have a heart to lead, but not love Jesus. Big difference. It's better to lead while you love Jesus. Diotrephes didn't love Christ. He didn't love God's word. He just wanted to lead. So keep that in mind. Therefore, verse 10, if I come, I will call to mind his deeds, which he does, prating against us with malicious words. And not content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. Verse 11, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is of God, but he who does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has a good testimony from all, and from the truth itself. And we also bear witness, and you know that our testimony is true. Let's pray, church. Father, be with us this morning. I pray, Father, for the brothers and sisters watching, that you would speak to them. Father, teach us that even in the uncertainty, even in the unknown, we are called to be leaders. We are called to still seek your leadership. And that, God, we are still called to be filled with your spirit in the unknown. In Jesus' name, amen. So some of you may be thinking, why is Pastor Steve going to talk about leadership in the midst of the coronavirus? And I'm going to do that because if you study the Bible, God's people are still called to lead in the midst of the uncertainty. Just think about it. Throughout the book of Acts, the uncertainty is taking place. Brothers and sisters don't even know if they're going to see the next day because of the persecution in Rome. But even in the midst of the uncertainty, they're still called to be leaders. Amen. And so this morning, I just want us to continue our series in 3 John. And specifically, we're going to talk about two traits that a leader should have. First, a leader should be protective. We're going to see that in verses 9 and 10. And second, it's going to be this. Leaders are called to be an example. We're going to see that in verses 11 and 12. And so first, be protective. We're going to see that in verses 9 through 10. Let's read verse 9 real quick. I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. So here in these two verses, or in this first verse, we see that John is writing to the church that Diotrephes is present at, but Diotrephes doesn't receive God's word. And to understand this, you have to understand that John is an apostle. And here's three roles that's in your notes of an apostle. First, an apostle is called to teach God's word. And real quick, if you're watching, turn to 1 John with me real quick. Turn to 1 John chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 1 through 4 for you. This is John writing about Jesus. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. Now you say, Pastor Steve, why did you read those verses? Well, in 1 John, John is declaring to us that he spent time with the real physical Jesus. John is declaring to us that he heard from the physical Jesus. In other words, John is declaring that he has the authority to write to the church because ultimately he heard from Jesus. And if you go read Paul's letters in your own spare time, you'll see that Paul says, I'm an apostle that's been called by God. In other words, John didn't wake up one day and say, I'm going to be an apostle. He was called by the living God to be an apostle. And in 3 John, we see that Diotrephes rejects, ultimately, God's word. He rejects God's authority. In other words, Diotrephes is in a dangerous spot. Diotrephes is rejecting apostolic authority. And that's not good. And church, let me just say this, even you all watching online, you all that are here, it is not a good thing to reject God's word. And if we're going to be leaders, if we're going to refocus on leadership, even in the uncertainty, we have to get back to God's word. This word is the authority of your life, my life, and the life of Peace Baptist Church. So three things real quick that apostles did. First, they taught God's word. Second, they set up leadership in the local churches. Third, they were called to be an example to God's people. And Diotrephes is rejecting this. And so, part of being protective, y'all listen to this, is that we're protective over this word. Amen? Word, type word. Like, we must be protective over this word. Diotrephes in verse 9, read it again. I write to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have preeminence among them, does not receive us. He rejects God's word. Didn't Jesus say that would happen in the last days? That they would reject his word, that wolves would come into the churches and try to twist the word of God. And here, a wolf, Diotrephes, has come into the church and has rejected the word of God. It's a big no-no. And church, brothers and sisters, this book, we have to get back to it, even in the uncertainty. This book should guide our lives. Let me ask you, brothers and sisters watching, are you Diotrephes this morning? Are you rejecting the word? Or are you Gaius that you have seen in the previous weeks? He is receiving God's word. Who are we this morning? Two, we need to be protective over Christ's lordship. If you're at home, say Christ. If you're here, say Christ.
Christ.
And say lordship.
Lordship.
Like really, we have to get in mind, in our minds, that it's Jesus Christ that is Lord over our lives, your lives at home, your family's lives, and over our lives here at this church once we start gathering again. Christ is Lord, not you and me. Go back to verse 9. He describes Diotrephes. Look what he says about Diotrephes. But Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them. Listen to this. Diotrephes loved to lead, but he didn't love Christ and Christ's people. That's a big, dangerous place to be, church. And let me just say this to the leaders. If you love leading, but you don't love Jesus and his people, get out of leadership. If you don't love Jesus, if you don't love his people, it's wise that you have no form of leadership in the local church. Amen? And as leaders, biblical leaders, we must be protective over this. No leader should love himself more than they love Jesus. See, Diotrephes loved himself and his own lordship more than he loved Jesus' lordship. And so, question I think we all need to ask ourselves this morning, how did Christ view himself? All right, send your notes. You read Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Christ says this about himself: all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Second question I think you need to ask yourself, how did the early church view Christ? Well, if you go read Acts chapter 11, verses 19 through 24 in your devotion time tonight, they viewed Jesus as Lord. The early church said, he is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. And another question, see in your notes, I think another question to ask yourself this morning is, how did the leaders and apostles view Jesus? Read Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. But real quick, this morning, I do want all of us, you at home, everyone in this room, turn to Ephesians chapter 1 real quick. Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to look at Ephesians chapter 1 real quick, verses 20 through 23. And when you're there, type word. Or say word. Ephesians chapter 1. We'll read verses 20 through 23. And take a sip of H2O. Mm-hmm. Or you can take a sip of your coffee or your milk this morning. If you're eating cereal, take a quick bite of your cereal. If you're eating eggs, throw the eggs at your kids. Have some fun. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 20 through 23. Listen what Paul writes. Which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. What's that mean? Jesus Christ is in control. Amen. Jesus Christ has all authority, not you and me. You see, what's happened so long in our churches, y'all listen to this. We come into the church and we want lordship instead of acknowledging Jesus who has lordship. Jesus Christ is Lord. He is master. And Paul's writing that. If you study the previous verses, he's writing that in the context, you've been redeemed. You've been forgiven for all of your sins. God has chosen you in Christ. You have the Holy Spirit in Jesus. Therefore, come under his loving lordship.
That's right.
But you don't come under the lordship of a God that just doesn't love you. You come under the lordship of a loving God. And Diotrephes back in 3 John says, I don't want no part of that. Instead, I want preeminence. You see, brothers and sisters, whenever that's our mindset, we're not being biblical. Our mindset should be, Jesus is Lord. He is the one that has authority over all the earth, over all of heaven, and here in the church. Word.
Word.
See, listen to this. Diotrephes had it all mixed up. Jesus Christ, the first century church, and the leaders in the first century church all confirm Jesus is Lord. Listen to this. Diotrephes is convinced that lordship belongs to him. And I'll just say this. The leaders and all believers, we must protect Christ's lordship. Amen. If we see any leader, and I'll just be bold here, any leader, any member declaring they have lordship, that they're in total control, we must confront that brother or sister in love and be like, no, sir. Christ is Lord at Peace Baptist Church. And we must remind ourselves of this daily. Everything we do comes under the authority of God, even in the uncertainty. Amen. We must not think with our own thoughts. We must not get caught up in our own emotions. We must say, what does Jesus say? Diotrephes didn't do that. Diotrephes is a wolf in sheep's clothing that wants people to worship him. So listen to this. We preach, we teach, and we submit to this lordship. Third, we must protect God's mission. Look at verse 10. Therefore, everyone at your home, say therefore.
Therefore.
If I come, I will call to mind his deeds, which he does. Meaning this, John loves God's people in such a way that he will protect God's people. Let me say that again. John loves God's people so much that he will come and call out Diotrephes for the injustice that Diotrephes is doing to God's people. Right? Because we must do that because, listen, God's mission is at stake. And if we're going to truly be on mission, we have to protect each other. We have to protect God's flock, leaders, that he has called us to serve and to shepherd. John says, when I get there, I'm going to call you out. Imagine if we started practicing that kind of church discipline. That we will not let God's people be abused. That if we see someone abusing God's people, we will come to them and lovingly say, this is not happening at Peace Baptist Church. Amen. God's people must not be abused. They must be loved. Amen? John says beloved several times in this book. And he wants to protect God's people because he wants to ultimately protect God's mission. And so let's look at this. Look what he says. Therefore I will come and I will call to mind his deeds, Diotrephes, which he does. Pranting against us with malicious words and not content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. So listen to this. We protect God's leaders and people. Amen? God's mission involves leaders and all of God's redeemed people. And so first, real quick, Diotrephes was trying to ruin the reputation of the apostles. You ever met somebody like that? They really don't have anything against you, but they would just love to ruin you. And I'll just say this, that comes from a self-centered heart, a heart that wants to be worshipped whenever you go around and you try to ruin the reputation of God's people, specifically God's leaders that you have no dirt on, you just want to ruin them for your own glory. That's what Diotrephes is doing. Ultimately, he was trying to ruin their reputation because he wanted to be worshipped. Listen to this, beware of the temptation to ruin a man or a woman in leadership for your own worship and elevation. Let me say that again. Beware, listen to this, beware of the temptation to ruin one of God's leaders because you want to be elevated and you want people to worship you. In church, we have to protect each other. We have to protect God's people from those that won't self-worship and don't want to point God's people to Christ's worship.
Amen.
Amen. We have to protect the body of Christ at peace. We have to protect the leaders at peace. But listen to this. He doesn't just call out, hey, they're verbally abusing the leaders, but he says they're abusing the rest of God's people too. So, in other words, John is trying to protect us, not just to protect each other, leaders. He's calling us to protect all of God's people. Amen? Because we've seen churches specifically, we've seen leaders, they have their own group, and they just want to protect each other, but they don't want to protect the rest of God's people. A biblical church, leaders, listen to this, we'll protect each other, but we will protect God's people. Amen? We must protect all people. Listen to what he says in verse, the last part of verse 11 or 10. So they're abusing God's leaders verbally. And listen to this. Not just content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren, meaning the rest of God's people, specifically in this context, the missionaries. And he forbids those who wish to put them out of the church. Listen to this. Diotrephes was trying to hinder the spread of the gospel. In other words, he was being Satan himself. The influence of Satan was living in the life of Diotrephes. Satan loves to hinder God's mission. In two ways he does that. He will put it in the heart of people to verbally abuse leaders, and he would put it in the heart of people to hinder God's mission. And we must protect that, church. We must protect the mission of God. We have to protect leaders. We have to protect each other. No work of Satan must be done in God's house. We have to protect each other. So the solution, listen to this, John is going to publicly call out Diotrephes when he gets to the church. John is going to inform the church that Diotrephes isn't a biblical leader. Just sink that in. Just think about that while I take another sip of water. In other words, John isn't going to slip the unethical actions of Diotrephes under the rug. When he gets to that church, he's going to be like, bro, if you're not saved, Jesus Christ is Messiah. And if you are saved, you better stop. Sure. Amen? Yeah. We must be gentle as doves, right? But we must be bold as lions. We must correct people in love and in gentleness, but we can't let God's people be abused. We can't let God's leaders be abused, and we can't let leaders abuse God's people. That's right. So first, be protective over God's people, right? Be protective over God's mission. Be protective over Christ's lordship. And be protective over God's word. You have the notes there, and I'm going to challenge you for some homework tonight, so just stay put. So lastly, I want us to say two together. Say two with your family.
Two.
Say
be.
And.
Yeah.
Example.
An example.
Let's look at verses 11 through 12 real quick together. We'll read those verses. Everybody say beloved.
Beloved.
As you can see, this is probably one of John's favorite words. And remember, it has this idea that I have a great affection for you. That God has sovereignly put a love in my heart that could only come from him. He says, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. He who does good is of God, but he who does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has a good example from all. And from the truth itself, we also bear witness, and you know that our testimony is true. So, you see in verse 11, he says, do not imitate what is evil, right? In other words, there are negative examples. There are leaders that aren't good leaders. Amen? Like, we all know that. If you've been in church long enough, if you've been living in the world long enough, if you've studied history long enough, you know that evil leaders do exist. And sadly, in 3 John, that evil leader is in the church. And he says, don't imitate that. Right? Be aware that there could be evil leaders in the church, but you better not imitate them. In other words, you better address them and tell them to step down. But listen to this. So the negative example you see ultimately in this book, specifically in this context, is Diotrephes. He is full of himself, has no desire for the Lord, and treats God's people harshly. That's the negative example. That's evil in the sight of God. Listen to this. Full of self is evil in the sight of God. Being so self-centered that you treat people harshly is evil in the sight of God. He has no desire for the Lord, yet he has a leadership role in the church. That's evil in the sight of God. And he treats God's people harshly. That is definitely evil in the sight of God. He says, don't imitate that. In other words, that word imitation has this idea of you conforming your life to something. Don't conform your life to self-centeredness, a lack of passion for the Lord, and a life that just treats people harshly. Don't imitate that. Amen? Word? God has redeemed us, church. He has redeemed us to love each other, treat each other with gentleness and love and compassion. Will there be bumps and bruises along the road? Absolutely. But we handle those bumps and bruises in a different way. We don't bash each other. We don't gossip about one another. We don't slander one another. We don't put each other out of the church out of hate and self-centeredness. We love each other. He says, don't imitate what's evil. So the positive example specifically in this book is John, Gaius, and Demetrius. These leaders are full of love for the Lord and his people. They're full of hospitality. They're full of God's word and his mission. He says, imitate those kind of leaders. Amen. Leaders that are full of God's mission. They love God's word. They love God's people. You need to find leaders like that, and you need to follow them as they follow Jesus. And isn't that what Paul says in the book of Philippians? He says, imitate me. Go read it. Go read it for homework tonight. Go read the book of Philippians. He says, imitate me as I imitate the Lord. There are people worth looking at as they point you to Jesus, in other words. But there's people, man, you don't need to imitate them because they're full of hate. They don't love God's people. Their fruit shows in time. Don't follow them. Call them out for their evilness. In church, let me just say this, everyone watching. We have to get back to the reality that God has called us to hold each other accountable, and he has called us to say, brother, sister, what you just did is not biblical, especially if that person's in leadership.
Amen.
Right? And so, peace. John writes this in the uncertainty, right? But this is a good leadership book in the midst of uncertainty. And so, the question I have in your notes is this. What kind of leader will you be? Be a Diotrephes, full of yourself? You don't want people to worship Jesus. You want people to worship you. You reject God's word. You're full of hate. You're full of anger. You're full of bitterness. You hinder God's mission. What kind of leader? Are you going to be like Diotrephes? Or are you going to be like Gaius, John, and Demetrius? Full of love. Full of hospitality. Ready to get God's mission completed. Amen. Trusting in the Holy Spirit to just really open up the doors like John saw in the book of Acts. He saw God just opening up doors left and right. Even when the devil wanted to hinder the mission of God, God would drop down and boot the devil out. That's the kind of church I want to be part of. Like, listen, brothers and sisters watching. When we get serious about God's mission, you better believe the devil and his agents will rise up to try to hinder this mission. But by God's power, we must continue the mission of God. We must continue to train leaders, to be biblical leaders, to be sound leaders, and protect what takes place at this church. When that happens, the devil is coming. He is coming. And sometimes his agents rise up, and they're sitting at peace. But look at John. He's going to confront the agents of the devil. And he's going to encourage the people of God. Gaius, Diotrephes, stay on mission. Continue to love God's people. Continue to not be served, but to serve like Jesus did. Because y'all listen, we're called to be leaders. Listen to this. Because Christ is the ultimate leader. He led you out of hell. He led you out of no relationship with him. He has filled you with His presence. Therefore, leaders, let's lead. Therefore, all of God's people, let's be on mission. And let's open up this. This is the authority. We have to get back to this. Not what does Pastor Steve think, what do you think, what does God think, and how do we align our lives to this? Especially to leadership. Amen? And so, church, watching, I just encourage you for your homework tonight. Go, you have the notes. Go read the previous notes and say, all right, what's this mean for me? All right? Like, if it's God's word, right, I'm telling you, go study the word for yourself and then go to the notes. Go read 3 John and say, how does this change my life? How does this change my family's life? How does this change the workplace that I'm at? How does this change the community I'm in? How does God want to use His word to change me in the context of being an active, let me say that again, active member here at Peace, not just someone that comes and sits when we start gathering again? How does 3 John impact my personal life and my corporate life? You have the notes. Go read them tonight. Amen.
Amen.
And let me just say this. I believe God's teaching us many things through this chapter of our lives. I think one thing He's teaching us is that you can actually open up your Bible at home. Amen. Like, we have to get back to the reality. Listen to this. That you don't just open up your Bible when you come here, but you open up your Bible at home and you let God transform your life. You let God transform your family's life, and you let God use that transformation to impact this corporate body. Amen. So open up your Bible at 6:00 tonight. Look at the previous notes. Open up to 3 John and say, all right, fam, how does this impact our family life? How does this impact our individual lives? How does this impact our life at Peace? So, take it seriously. And just know this, we're praying for you. We love you. We're here to serve you. I think Carol sent out a phone tree. To let you know that if you need anything, you just reach out to us this week. And my prayer for us, church, we got one more sermon in this series of Refocus on Leadership. Next, we're going to talk about be a friend. And I'm going to give you ways that you can just be a friend. So be praying over that. Be praying like God would. I think we go through books of the Bible and we forget what we learned. Start like putting this stuff deep within, especially if it's coming from this. So y'all be praying. And y'all be in 3 John this afternoon. Study the notes you already have and let God change your life. Let's pray. Father, thank you for our brothers and sisters watching right now or will watch this afternoon. We pray, Father, that you would use this sermon, this lesson to challenge, to conform, and to convict. Help us, God, to be more and more like Jesus in our leadership. Help us to protect your word. Help us to protect your lordship. Help us to protect your mission, God. Help us to be on our toes, God. Help us to be watchful over your people so they're not abused. God, help us to be an example. In Jesus' name.